Okay, so last time, did a second round of work on the B boss, adding the orbit attack, where the idea is basically the bees like fly in a line towards the player, then orbit in a circle around him, then exit. I got the foundation of that behavior down, but didn't really I don't know, it had some buggy edge cases. So yeah, offline did tons of work on the B boss. It's like pretty close to being in like a done state, I think, at this point. Here, I'll close game. A little bit more polish could be done, and I probably will at some point in the future, but like definitely in a more polished state than the rat boss. And yeah, the part of getting that better polish was moving to a new version of Unity. Basically, I went in to look at light 2D support, and because I was on 2019, I think you had to jump through some hoops because like light 2D support was experimental. So I'm like, all right, whatever, I'll just, bite the bullet, upgrade. I want, since I'm not really a artist, so I need access to these like better visual features to get to good game visuals, because I can't just draw a bunch of stuff. So yeah, that moving to the new version of Unity gives me access to light 2D, and it also gives me access to post-processing. So I implemented that on the B boss. Oh hey, Tyson in the chat, how's it going? And also I fixed the ledge grab. It used to be that you like hung on the ledge and then could climb up or fall down, like with an additional right or left. But that was part of the problem that was making like ledge grab so inconsistent. So I'm like, screw it, just always climb up if you ledge grab. It's a pretty narrow thing you have to go for. So here, yeah, we got glow in the background. We're also using it to telegraph, like it was warning me the orbit attack there. It was warning me it's sending a bee in my direction and bopping back. It's feedback for hitting the boss. So yeah, this is really only like half a day of messing around with the new post-processing pipeline, and a lot of figuring out initial problems. So with some like with more learning and more like work on this, I think I can probably get really good results. But it's, oh my God, just send a guy. These blue guys, you wanna stay still for a second. Just let them all get in a clean orbit. What do you mean the black is too much? Like the background, it should be a grayer. Oh no, see, look at that broken orbit. They're like obliterating me. So hard to dodge if they're not in a clean orbit. Yeah, I think that would be a round of, oh God, I'm getting blasted. Now she's like, she's got no guys, so she's gonna run away. What was I saying? I think that'd be good for a round of, oh no, don't die. I would be good for a round of upgrades on this. Because, man, I'm just getting, I might die even though I have 30 debug lives. Might be good for a round of upgrades. Yeah, I just oh my God, I died. I had died through 30 lives. Yeah, I know. It needs to like pull. I think I can just I think it just needs lines, right? It's just an AABB, which is not precise enough. It needs to be like a diamond. Oh, maybe I just rotate the AABB 45 degrees. I wonder if that's still cheap to do. Because the whole point of AABB is it's like super cheap. But if she's just doing the same runaway behavior, but her bounds are like a diamond, keeping her in like roughly the center of the screen, so like the play jumpable area. Oh, just trigger the bounce logic. Yeah, that's, it's like, oh my god, I'm getting blasted. That is like a script that like not only I have, but is on the queen. That is her logic for when she has like a medium amount of bees. She just does a generic wander, and if she hits a wall, it rerolls her random wander direction to a like a vector reflect to be a bounce. God. If she has like most of her bees, I think it's more than 50%, she is super aggressive. Oh, I bumped on the corner. Oh man, just obliterated there. I got bumped on the corner. Oh, this is the last hit. This is the angry eyes. I should just run away and live. Oh my. Yeah, we need to fix the invulnerability window. But just believe. I mean, I guess I'll do one more round. I can beat it. But I'm just not paying as much attention. I need to fix the invulnerability window on the player. Yeah, this sound is like, this like specific background track that's going on right now is from my like boss rush king dungeon, that one game jam. This is the song that played when you fought the mushroom guy. So yeah, I just knew I had like, I already took the time to find like 8 decent, or like 6, I forget how many bosses there were. I took the time to find like a few decent CC0 tracks for this boss rush game. I can just grab one of those as my placeholder boss music. But yeah, there, like pretty much all the audio is temp. I haven't really taken steps to make the audio good yet. When I'm doing like game jams, my philosophy is like basically everything needs a visual and a sound, like every relevant change in game state should both have a sound effect and like a little some kind of sprite change animation, anything like that. Oh man, getting blasted still. This is probably overtuned, but again, it's hard to tell when I'm getting multi-hit when I should have like some kind of temporary invulnerability on damage. Guess like a figure eight? What do you mean? Oh, I died. See, I can't read chat and bees at the same time, but it's okay. When the number of bees. Yeah, I think would it just mean to be wider, maybe? I do have the capability to increase the range every time. So I could make it every time you get to the next phase where you're rocking one more bee, it's also a slightly wider range. It's like just as a oh maybe. Yeah, that just like having offsets. Gotcha. Yeah, I'll have to. I know. I agree with you that especially when there's too many, like the only move really is to run for a while. Or try to like get that suicide run if you got a bunch of lives, I guess. But like, I only have a like a ridiculous amount of lives because I'm debug testing. All right, she's only got 2 more hits. I can get it. I definitely killed it many times in testing. I just was wavy. Oh, perfect. Line that up. Oh God. Oh, I got her. She just suicided into me. Probably shouldn't do that, but that's okay. So yeah, but compared to the Rat King, I think this is in a much more polished state. Yeah, you can communicate Visual Studio. So yeah, but to get access to that post-processing stack and to get access to 2D lights, which I haven't even really used well yet, I had to update my Unity version, which I'm sure you know if you're like a dev, updating like the version of the thing you're using is always like a little bit of an annoying thing. And it did take, like, my shaders were all broken at first. I had to fix that. Some of the paths became wrong. I had to, there's like a one-time migration that missed a couple files, so I had to like revert it in version control and then do the one-time migration again, and it worked the second time. So yeah, a lot of little annoyances like that. But I do think it's worth it because I think, you know, since I can't like learn art in a month to the point where I would significantly increase the quality of the visuals just by adding art. Since that's not in the cards, the way to move forward is just using whatever visual polish tools Unity offers me to like the fullest of their ability. And I think, you know, lights and post-processing are a good place to start for that. Okay. So, we're doing this time. Burrow boss. So the idea is this would probably be here. I can also show this. This would probably be the one of the first rounds of bosses with a slightly tuned down version of the Rat King, where it's basically just like a whack-a-mole. He pops up, you stomp him, he throws some stuff at you type thing. It will be a heck of a lot easier than the Waffs Queen. Although the Wasp Queen is probably super overtuned for her place in the game right now. Yeah, let me add those B notes though while I'm thinking of it. I'll hop back to the boss in a sec. Offline plans, notes, or I guess like misc. E. Expand circle radius on. Gaining more bees. Maybe chill with speed increases. Oh yeah, that's I forgot to put that in my offline, but here I can show that now. I also did the boss controller base class to give me some like convenient interfaces to hook into here. I actually want to open this. Visual Studio 2016. So if I go to scripts here, bosses, boss controller base. We have it doesn't switch for portrait mode yet. That's what this note is. But we have this base class here to make the implementation of future bosses convenient. It like sets up a system for checking phases based on health and like adjusting some basic things like a move speed and attack timer frequency as phases change. It handles like the differentiation between like spawning a boss, like the controller and the spawner, deals with that. Subscribes to the damage and death events. You know, damage does phase change stuff. I can go to the B boss script here to give you to show how this works. So like there's spawn boss, right? And then spawn boss will call it derived on spawn boss. So this is like an override where you know, all these just sort of have like parent version and then a virtual derived version that does nothing by default but can be overridden. So like as an example here, I know how this is how I do. Oh, also you can make your own phase here. I wanted to be able to adjust the orbit speed automatically with this like phase system, or at least store it, I guess. So this is like a B phase. This is a derived phase class that still works with the parent thing. And see, like, I just got a nice, you know, constant array of values here where I can just tweak stuff. So I would add probably like orbit ranges here. Oh yeah, that's a good point too. Yeah, maybe like an AI module for this type of idea. I could see that for sure. I mean, I think it has the player by default. Let me see the boss controller base. Yeah, it does. So it holds on to the player. So it does have some degree of that. It has like an awareness of the player, but that's more like a coding convenience than any sort of like conclusion that's gone through some processing. But yeah, so an extension of this sort of idea. That would be something you probably want to opt into because arrays are the most expensive thing. But yeah, it's the ability to opt into it for sure. Sensor callback option to opt into generalized sensors. Like cardinal raycasts. Yeah, maybe. I guess the problem I felt with that is, I don't know. It feels like the specifics of the enemies, can potentially be so different that, zero references. How can this be? Oh, it's probably invoked, right? Yeah. Anyway, yeah, so this is one of the other things I worked on. I use my B controller script here as like sort of the pilot test case for developing my boss controller base class. And hopefully that boss controller base class will be a help today and let us get further along sort of planned tasks here. So what are those plan tasks? First, we're gonna hop into paint and just sort of draw the various attacks you want. I just always like to have that paint drawing in case I forget or in case I don't know, I just like to have it. Then we're gonna make the boss level. And once we have the boss level, it'll be the burrow behavior, which probably is just gonna be popping up, popping back down, and teleporting around sort of between the various places. And then we'll add like the sort of element of danger of like shooting stuff, either like chucking rocks or projectiles coming out of when he appears. Maybe that can be a phase hook where like, the appearance gets more and more dangerous. Then decoys. So the idea for the burrow boss here would be he pops up, he throws junk at you, you dodge it, you bonk him on the head, that's it. It's simple, but this is one of the bosses for the for the very beginning, so it should be simple. And yeah, so with that bonking on the head thing, I think as a phase thing, like later on in the fight, you would have like different like some kind of hint that it's wrong. I don't know what that hint would be, but a version like of the burrow warning or whatever, saying like that boss is gonna pop up here that is fake, and if you go for that, frame perfect stomp trying to get him as soon as he comes up, doing that will cause you to take damage. And then just to round it out, I like having three attacks. I think just a debris attack, spawn junk from the ceiling. It's a pretty standard earth coded thing to do. I guess I should add here damage. We'll see if we get to that. The boss actually like being taking damage and being forced back down, integrating that with the movement behavior. Okay, so Yeah, let's get started with paint planning. So I figure you have something like tiled base, right? To sort of indicate that there's something in here he can be in. It gives a warning, little rumble type thing. Probably want one in the middle as well. So I have to connect it. I guess they would be like connected by the vine, right? Even though the vines aren't in the boss level yet, but just imagine there's a vine. And then maybe one-way platforms here to just make the arena more navigable. Yeah, so this would be our base arena. And Burrow would be something like, where are my tools at? What is just undo a launch? Control Y. There you go. Tools, there they are. They always disappear, the tools. And you would have the boss here. Your line is fine. And you shoot out projectiles. This I want a paintbrush for. Why is it still in the line? What the heck? Oh, whatever. Projectiles. And if you bonk them, the player's usually pink, right? Bonk them. He will get forced back down. Or just thought I had the select tool. Also, if you so on what? Also just on a timer, he'll go back down. This is color. Okay, and then he will basically like relocate. That's the idea. From here, you're there. There. Okay. So let's just give me space below here. Make it a different color so it's easy to paint select. Space below here. And so it's the decoy and ceiling. So decoy idea would be like got sort of the real guy here and a fake guy here. I'll just put nothing, but also the same sort of thing. Check here. X here. Red X, I mean. And this would just shoot a bunch of projectiles. This would be the guy you actually want to stomp. So yeah, that would be like the decoy bait attack type deal. And then the last thing would just be I mean I don't know if you need to draw this one, but just the ceiling thing. I guess the only thing I want to note about ceiling thing, yeah, I grabbed the wrong thing. I should grab the blank. Is I think I want it to go outward from the guy. So if our guy is here, ceiling would like radiate outward down. Yeah, this is the rough paint plan outline of what behaviors we want to support for our burrowing guy. So I can cross that off. Okay, let's set up a scene. I think I'm going to use the scene as my base just because if I want to just like crank up the post-processing for fun, I can. Or like maybe if I go really fast, get a bunch of work done, I can interact with that a little bit, but just, I don't know, better setup. I mean, ultimately, I'm going to probably have to fix up all these levels to actually integrate them into the sort of like full sort of full game. So the duplicate boss test B, rename it boss test Burrow. That up. You're gonna get rid of the hex background. Gonna get rid of this test light. This is a glow. Okay, global right light is fine. This, I don't know what this is. I think I meant to delete this. I think this was for the hexes before I learned post-processing. Or no, this is the, yeah, I don't know. I don't think I need this. Platforms, boss UI canvas, what's on this? Oh, the health bar. And a UI group switcher, but the scene isn't really set up for it, so let's not worry about that. Temp boss music is fine. This B boss controller we should remove. And that's the tile map. All right, let's hop in here. Make sure everything works okay from this point. All right. Yeah, I mean, nothing going on, but scene loads. And start throwing some stuff in here. We can start decorating it or like outlining how we want. So I'm thinking, right, three platforms with a maybe like an edge. Let's see, let's just start drawing on the tile map a little bit here. Window panels. Where's tile map? I guess 2D maybe. Tile palette. The main one. I feel like this aspect of Unity might, the new Unity might annoy some people, but I actually don't mind it. It's just that it always tells you what it's doing now. You might, I think you might incorrectly feel like, oh, it's Unity is telling me it's loading all the time now. It must be slower. No, I mean, at least my anecdotal experience is it is slightly faster. It's just that it was not giving you messages before, so yeah, you were just wondering what it was doing. What, and it just seemed like it was freezing up. Yeah, I mean, I guess we'll have to see. I am still on a branch. I have not merged Unity 2022 back to master yet, so I still do have like a sort of a master stream I can revert to if I find some horrible like breaking problem that makes Unity 2022 not work for me. But so far so good. And like not only you know, once I got over the initial hump of compatibility fixing, once I got over that hump, it's just it's mostly just worked how would I would expect it to. And in some areas, having slight improvements. Probably wants to go slightly further out. I don't want to keep angling it, but I'll start using that. Drawn platform. Let's use a triple here. You can see the effect of post-processing, kind of, where this is like a boring brown and it's getting contrasted up here a little bit to like a brown orange. I think like high contrast is gonna be the way to go here for me here. I can turn it up even more. That's like really dramatic. Contrast, you can also, oh, and saturation as well. Yeah, I don't know if this is better, but definitely some amount of contrast and saturation. But I've just scratched the surface of playing with this stuff, so looking forward to hopefully being able to make some cool stuff. Do have some familiarity with graphic stuff, so like once I'm familiar in the UI and sort of the way of doing things, I should be able to some decent results. Yeah, I think we're gonna put, maybe this should be one down. You can just, I was thinking maybe a one-way platform in the middle, but like then you never get back down weirdly. I guess I would make this bigger maybe. Yeah, maybe that's the way. Then you could still have a one-way platform. Yeah, I think that's the way. We're gonna stretch this out. I gotta keep in mind, like, my default is like, oh, challenge. Be sure there's challenge. But as the first boss, you should just need to fight that instinct and chill a little bit. It's fine if it's a little bit easy. It's supposed to be a little bit easy. And that trimming. So I messed up my. Okay, let's ditch a lot of these platforms. Only want like two one-way platforms, so these are kind of just like in the way as I'm drawing stuff here. Platforms, all but two, and we'll just move these to. Like here, and the other point here. And fix this corner. Also add this on the other side. That is four from the camera bound there. You just keep going. Corner. Then it is, yeah, also to the camera bound. Oh, but it needs to be one down. Cool. Bits. An edge. Then it starts ticking down at the camera bound. Wait a second. This doesn't seem symmetrical. What did I do wrong? Yes, it is. Oh no, it is. I don't know why I didn't look it. And then we just fill in this. All right, now put the platforms at some like actual reasonable position. I don't know, like just so they can match. Okay, so we'll go negative or 6.5 in like either direction and 0.5 in the Y, negative 0.5. Then we just add a block up here to the middle. So we move this over one more. Then he actually needs to go further up if it's going to be the top. All right, I think this is decent. We're using most of the space. Is our guy a few places to pop up? I guess the question is it annoying to get back down? I don't think so. It's fine. Like, it's, you wouldn't want these one-way platforms to be like a nuisance. Well, I guess he appears like here. Maybe I want a little bit more vertical space. There is some area at the top we're not really using. Let's see that. Move these up one each. Or maybe even more than that, 1.5. Move this up a little bit as well. One up 1.5, that'd be like a 2D tile map. Why is it not letting me do tile map stuff? I don't understand. Oh, I have to select it probably. Yeah, there we go. No? Heck. I need to is that it? I need to click on that? I have no idea. There we go. I don't know. That was weird. Oh, just losing the control. Maybe this should probably be moved down one. You need to do the like the max height jump to make it, and sometimes you don't even make it. So let's do that. Something about, I think like I need to interact with the tile map in some way before it'll let me do that. Oh, dang it, I need to grab one more. There we go. Fill in the edges. Should be, it's basically impossible to fall to your death here, but again, that's to some degree by design. And that's an easier jump. Is this still reachable? Pretty much. It can probably pop down a half, though. And that'll... just for a little bit of looks. Also, we'll have the vine going up there eventually, but just a bit more of a feeling of like a place you can burrow into, just a bit more space in this platform. We'll slightly interfere with the navigability of this area, but I don't think it will significantly. I can just check really quick. Kind of this weird, I like let go of my jump too quick. It seems fine to me. It also like gives some degree of symmetry with the edges. I think with the, you know, these one-way platforms up here, there's enough. It's no problem to hop up through one or even around one. Going around one doesn't even necessarily need to trigger the edge grab. Yeah, so plenty of space to jump around, but still using most of the space and having a few different places our guy can appear. I'm thinking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, I think we can call this subtask here of boss arena. So burrow movement behavior, and I guess I should add boss controller. Like this, its movement control will be sort of the first piece of logic in this boss controller. So let's go to scripts down here, resources. I guess not resources. Yeah, resources are for dynamically loaded things. Scripts, bosses, new C sharp script, burrow, boss controller. Actually, I changed my mind. Let's separate this out. We're gonna do spawn Basic boss prefab, boss controller, just doing the basic task of spawning the boss prefab. And then we'll add burrow behavior as the first thing once we spawn something into the world. Wait, one of these is wrong. Out of here. Okay. So, edit our burrow boss controller. Open it up here. This is not a mono behavior. This is a boss controller base. Zoomed in enough. All right, and it's going to say, hey, you have some abstract thing you need to define. And that's phases. It has to know what its phases are going to be. We will just steal that here from our B phase now and just have one phase, maybe two, yeah, one phase. Okay, these are get phases. It's not going to be a B phase, it's going to be a phase base. And 1.1 here is for 110%. That's what I'm just like putting the default thing at. Get rid of this orbit stuff. And oh, I guess I need that. Not actually. Can be null. I guess empty. I don't know if it can be null. Empty is safer than null. And then these are the things that I don't need because they're B data.
Okay.
Oh wait, we already have it. So yeah, this is mostly just placeholder stuff. Except attack frequency. This is relevant. We want to turn this down probably for testing, just so its attack timer is rolling more often. We want to grow like test stuff in our attack timer trigger. We can do that. Why is this? This needs not a semicolon. That's what it's telling me. Okay. All right. So yeah, this is the only thing we have to provide. Everything else is optional to override. So get rid of all the stuff except that. We have our Burrow boss controller. Let's throw it in our scene. Burrow boss controller. See, you have a few things here that just like the base class of the boss controller expects. So we're gonna give it the player. We're gonna give it oh, we don't have the prefab yet. That's what we'll make next, but the boss health bar, we'll just use this bees one. I guess I should throw the text change. I mean, it'll take a second. Boss health bar parent, boss text. Instead of bees, we're now give burrow. Burr. I think burr is what it's gonna be. Okay, so we got Burr the Burrower. And he needs a prefab, so let's create a new object to be that prefab. Say 2D object. Well, let's just start with an empty. Burrow boss. Okay, what is this gonna need? It's gonna need, well, first of all, let's fix the dumb things. I think we want to add as well. We need China object. I don't think so. Let's add a box collider. Will be a trigger. Sprite renderer. I can show. I have it open still, yeah. Use this guy for this. And then he has maybe we can make use of this animation as well. But yeah, it's gonna be a big version of this for the base. I might end up modifying it, like I turn the wasp into the queen bee. But for now, we're just gonna do a square. You know, having sprites other than squares are for people who have functionality that works. All right, so there's our square. Let's move it way up in the layer so it's likely to appear on front. And what else do we need? Doesn't have an enemy knockback trigger. Doesn't have like a damage thing. Only its projectiles will have damage. And we don't want it to actually have physics. We're just gonna like teleport it around under the ground and peek it up and peek it back down type deal. So yes, is this it? Is this all we re Oh, I guess we need a health because we are giving it a health bar. 999 is too many. Let's say 7. So there's a health. Let me double check the bee queen. See if there's anything like on there that would remind me something that should be on here. Scripts. I need to go to resources, bosses, bee boss. Okay. A movement clamper. I guess he's not moving. I'm teleporting him around. Sprite renderer, sure. Movement controller, not needed. This timer is related to the movement controller. Animator, probably, but not yet. Facing, yes, but not yet. So yeah. Just looking through, it seems like our square actually has all it needs for us to get started. I guess. Oh wait, why did? Then I add a sprite renderer too. Oh whoops, I added to the post-processing object. Paste. It's new. I mean, I don't even need to copy really. I didn't change. Whatever. I should set this to 7. Wish I could cut component. Put it on the wrong thing. It's two operations to remove. Okay, let's give it like a burrow color. Just what is this color? Let's just steal the color from the game. I like brown orange, sure. And he'd probably be slightly bigger than this, say that big. All right. So there's our guy. Let's make him a prefab. Delete him from the world. Then go to our boss controller and we tell the boss controller our boss prefab is the Burrow boss in assets. Okay. Now, the boss controller base, I believe, does not actually spawn the boss. You have to, yeah, this is protected. The child can call it. So yeah, I do have in the B boss, I just say on start spawn the boss, and that's probably what I'm gonna do here as well. But just to sort of explain my thinking here, I imagine like the final like most polished versions of the bosses will all have like an intro animation. Like I can imagine, for example, like the bee is like up in the top, right? You just like put like a line art beehive there, have the vine, the normal vine growth go up. You can have the vine growth shader also spawn in, you know, your leafy platforms as it's going up and just sort of bother the hive at the top, and then the queen comes out. And then you call spawn boss, is the idea. And I guess it'd be similar for this one. You can just have the vine come up and disturb the burrowy guy, have him spawn up here. But yeah, so that's why I have this as like a discrete callable function instead of just being called on start by default all the time. Just to have that possibility of an intro animation later on. But for now, for testing, we are going to call it on start. I'm going to say protected override void on start. I don't know if everybody does this, but I do. Like, you can't have the unity callbacks in the child and the base. It won't work. It'll only call one of them, I think, the child one. So, I mean, that makes sense by the rules of classes, right? But yeah, so I just have the pattern of, okay, the base class will interact with the unity stuff. And for every unity callback I might care about, I'll have a corresponding base class callback, like on start here. So then I don't have to worry about like, oh, this one needs to go on start, but this one needs to go on awake, and I put some base class logic in awake. I needed to have this thing before this other ball. Yeah, so no, we just base class always deals with unity, derived class overrides things. I think that's how it should be, but I guess that's a matter of opinion. Anyway, on start, call spawn boss. And I think this needs a position, so let's figure out where we want to spawn him. We're just gonna, as is tradition, use the player as our measuring stick here. Does that look good? Pretty much. So this is at 0, 8.71, probably 8.75. Control Z him back down to the normal spawn pot. And we add a private const float k spawn y top. And we said 8.75, but we actually want them to be underground, so I'm guessing it's 8.25. Actually, if he's double size, it would be 7.75, I think. Either that or even like 6. It might be 1.5. I don't know. We'll find out. Find out. It's okay. So we spawn boss at a new vector 3, 0.0f, a spawn y top. Oh, I should say that's another thing I like to. 2022 Visual Studio also seems to be an upgrade. Not always the case, but at least in both of these cases, once you get through the initial pain of the change, definitely an improvement to my experience. All right, what do we expect to happen? We expect the boss to spawn in here at the top and do nothing. And look, there he is. He didn't really spawn underground. So let's pop him down a little bit. I guess it's 7.25. Or I guess it might even be 6.75. I mean, I'll try 6.75, and I know it's 7.25 if 6.25 is too low. I mean, I probably wanted to be like in the base anyway. The other nice thing about this like domain thing or this like warning is I can see like, oh, it's taking some time completing domain. What's the deal with that? Is that something I can reduce? And I find out, yes, like you can turn off the like domain stuff. And the idea behind it is it's just like it resets everything, like static variables and stuff to get as close as possible to like a new player first boot up experience for debugging purposes. If you have really resilient code that isn't using like a bunch of static stuff or cleans it up well, you can turn off domain and you'll be perfectly fine. But it turns out I do not. My stuff is not set up for that. I tried turning off domain and it broke some logic the second time I debugged, which I knew I thought, you know, it might happen. There's always a possibility. But that gives me the option to, if I say like, hey, as a part of cleaning up reload bugs, what if I want to clean up sort of my need to set up a domain, and if I could do that, then I could turn off this Unity setting, and I imagine the like iteration time would be super fast. It's already increased, and now most of the time spent is spent waiting for domain, completing domain. Anyway, that was a long rant about the messing around with Unity 2022. The guy did spawn where we wanted him to spawn, so mission accomplished. We have our boss script. We have our guy being spawned by it. I think we can cross off our subtask here. Boss controller, spawn boss prefab. Doesn't do anything, but yeah, it has its own boss controller class, and it spawns its special prefab that we can now do some stuff to set up. All right, so this burrow movement behavior, this is basically two parts. Three parts. One is he goes up from being within the tiles. Two is he goes back down from either being bonked or just running out of time to bonk him. And then the three is teleporting from location to location to then pop up from. It occurs to me that we probably want to put him on like a very deliberate like middle layer so that he's hiding in the burrow area, you know what I mean? Hiding behind the tiles. Right now you can see him in front, but I think for debug purposes, we are going to keep him in front for now. All right, so this burrow movement behavior. So I guess we need a helper function that's like private void go up. Or I guess unburrow. Maybe do burrow cool eburrow. So if eburrow, we would go back down. But we don't care about that right now. We care about the else case where you unburrow. I guess I should just say be down. That's clearer. I don't even need to explain up. It's obvious. Okay, so if we're going up, what we need to do is really just like, I think, define a speed and a distance we need to go up here. I don't even think there's any use in using like the movement interfaces. Are there? I don't think so. I think directly, you know, it's nice to have those types of things, but a simple problem of this, just like peeking up and peeking down, I think it's an unnecessary complication that doesn't really buy me much. The main thing it buys me is like a family of components, like the movement clamper AABB, right? Where I don't have to worry about anything. If I'm using my standard movement system, I can clamp whoever's movement to an AABB, or like bouncing off the edge of an AABB, bouncing when you clamp, dying when you clamp, all that sort of stuff that's like interconnected. But at least top of mind and sort of looking at the paint plan here, I don't think we need any of that. We're up, we're going down, we're teleporting. That's it. So we're going up. I would say private const float k, I guess, unburrow distance. I think this is going to be, well, it's going to be a factor of scale. So maybe we say unburrow distance coef to private float m on burrow distance. Bad food. Until we set it. So that's another example of a nice to have thing. I can do protected override on spawn boss. So this just, I mean, this seems a little redundant maybe, but again, our spawn boss could be called from elsewhere in the future. And this also like ensures the instantiate happens, and like you basically By using this as a callback, you can make some assumptions, like including that, okay, M spawn boss and M spawn boss health and movement. Oh, I guess I am trying to use movement. I was thinking like I'm not using movement. Let's see. I guess if I use movement, I can hook into the boss base and have movement be on burrow speed. I think that's fine. You know, it wouldn't be hard to do myself, but you know, why not hook into the ability to? I would already want to customize that for phases, right? You probably want to make him give like slightly less warning as the fight goes on, I would imagine. So let's go to our burrow boss and add a translation-based movement. We can probably just call this directly. Back, we can just call this and oops, switched over. We can just call this while we're going up. Right? Call this while we're going up until we get to the place you want to get to, and then it just works with any movement speed as well. So yeah, I guess this is kind of the nice example of, you know, interfaces and component assumptions. At this timer, the distance, all that can just work. Let's do that. I think we want a state, maybe. If I need a state, maybe just a bool. Well, I guess I would want going up too. So we'll say private burrow state. Burrowing 0. Going up, I guess surfacing. One, diving. Two. Private enum burrow state. Private burrow state. My burrow state. Which will initially be burrowing. I found just like a state machine to be a useful pattern for the B boss. It just kind of makes sense. So let's repeat it here. I don't think it's like truly justified itself yet, but we'll see. It might be like the movement thing where well, the benefits aren't immediately obvious. I guess that's it's just like bound to be true as complexity increases. We add more and more things. Anyway, we'll do a private void change state burrow state. Yes. Switch. Yes. Case spelled state wrong. I have to fix that. Throwing. Break. Copy pasta the other cases. Surfacing. Diving. Always off by one word, one letter. So, right at the end of this, we actually say state equals yes. So all we really have to do here is call change state be down, if be down, burrow state. Diving. Else burrow states servicing. I guess there's a third one which is up. Surfaced, I guess. Should be maybe worded as burrowed and surfaced. Surfaced, diving, surfacing. Burrowed. Surface, we're missing. I like them to go in the same order. So we're gonna move diving up here. Bird. Okay, so we change state to. Maybe we should just have separate. I don't even know why this needs to be a function. If it's just going to be a change state, yeah, I don't think we need this. Let's get rid of this for now. We might use it again. I think the change state will be all we need, but we'll see. On start, we spawn the boss. When we spawn the boss, we want to change state into surfacing. And then I guess we want, let's surface target y is some value that we'll calculate right here, and we'll save. And k surface distance coef. I should say surface scale coef. Surface distance scale coef. Okay. So might as well also have private float m scale distance surface scaled distance coef. Okay. Set this value here on spawn. Because once we spawn the boss, we'll know how big the boss is. So this becomes m spawn boss dot transform dot scale local scale dot y, I guess. Technically you could use either, I guess, but like if we're talking about trying to calculate the distance it needs to move up and down, then yeah, it's y. So this times this. Or it's this times the k coef equals for this, and then just k surface distance scale coef times this water. Surface. So we get that coefficient. This isn't really a code, this is a distance. Okay. Then when we change the state, we would on burrow say m. This doesn't need to be surface. I think it should just be m current target y. Because in burrowed, we can say m current target y is equal to my current transform position, I think. Or my spawn boss, not mine. Let's get that at the top. Bar pos equals m spawn boss dot transform dot position. Pos plus. Or no, bird, if we're going down, it's minus m surface distance. I should have changed this from surface to m to, I mean, this is fine, I think. Negative surface distance is dive distance. That makes sense to me. Pos dot y minus here. Oh wait, yes, diving and servicing is what I want, but here it's plus. And it diving. Okay, so this is basically saying, hey, if I tell you to switch into the diving or the surfacing state, I want you to record your current position plus an offset, plus or minus an offset that represents like a factor of your scale, which will basically be, okay, how do we go back into the ground or get up out of the ground? And then in our update, we'll like move towards that. So we do something like protected, override, void, re-update. If m state, Burrow state is equal to surfacing, or we'll also deal with if m burrow state is equal to diving. We already have our movement interface because that's something that we just carry for free on our base class. We figure we need it a lot. It's the whole point of giving him a movement. So we say I'm spawn boss movement dot move. The direction of this is diving, vector two dot down and vector two dot one scale. I mean, just don't make it any bigger. Just use the, what's the problem? Vector two int dot down. So why is that in the wrong place? Int. Happy? There, yeah. Here, the same, but up. Anything else? In both cases, it doesn't really matter. So I think, hold on, I think I want to have sort of a vector two int move vec that is zero by default. Zero. What am I doing? And then we can just say this. Down. Doom spawn boss movement. Or I guess we should say if move back isn't zero. Then we would do our movement interface, spawn boss movement. Move in move vec at vector 2.1 as our scale. And then we would check if in spawn boss movement. I guess we just want to get a delta basically. Float. Delta is equal to my target y. And current target y minus my spawn boss movements. Not my spawn boss movement, my spawn boss dot y transform dot position dot y. There's our delta between the boss and where he's trying to get to. We would check if the delta is less than some like epsilon, let's say 0.1f. Less than, not greater than. And if it is, then we do change state. Guess I should just save the result of this. Say we'll be surfacing. I think the compiler will probably do this for me, but might as well be safe. Then I can branch on it here. Surfacing and burrow state surfaced Else Burrow State Burrowed. Right? So basically, this is switching from the movement to the more solid state when, yeah, so the idea of this pre-update, you have I have a pre-update and a post-update. It's just before or after the attack timer happens. Let's say we do our movement before, because if we get to up here, then we would want to start that attack timer ticking. But we'll deal with that in a second. Let's get this burrow behavior working first. So the idea here is, I mean, we won't see that significant a change in behavior. All we need Dang, my. There we go. Dang, my headset turns itself off if it doesn't get a sound for too long. It's telling me I've written too much code without testing it. So yeah, let's. But we're testing it now. We just need one more call here that. Oh wait, we already have it. Yeah. So after we spawn the boss, switch into the surfacing state. So this should lead to our guy to pop up out of the tile he starts in. And that's what it did. We've done it, everyone. So I guess as a maybe a little additional check here, we can try. That was pretty quick. I want it to be like kind of a slow surface, so I changed the movement speed here from 5 to 2. We would expect that to affect the surface speed. Let's see if that's the case. Yeah, maybe a little bit too slow. We can bump them up to 2.5. But yeah, there is our surfacing. So I think we have like two options. We can have sort of, I think we should have the surface timer be an independent constant from the attack timer. Because there is an existing attack timer system, right, where I could hook into that and I could say, okay, pause the attack timer when I'm doing this movement, but when I'm surfaced or when I'm burrowed, time for me to appear again, whatever, we'll do the timer. I think I want to leave the attack timer for doing the either the actually, I mean, if unburrowing it or like moving around is one of the three attacks. Maybe I roll randomly but have like a max time you can stay in one location. I guess, yeah, for testing, at least getting started, and let's see what it's like. We'll just use the existing callback for that. So I think on spawn or on start here, we would want to do spawn, or it's like pause attack timer or something. Yeah, so pause the attack timer until we switch into one of these other states. Actually, you know what? I prefer to just have this in the switch. So burrowed. Pause attack timer false. But diving and surfacing will pause the attack timer. This is what I like about the sort of the nice big state machine switch. It's I'm never wondering like, oh, which helper function am I doing this or that in? You just get a nice place to do all the relevant things and have a decent idea of how they maybe could relate to each other. So yeah, I didn't really test any. I didn't. There's nothing testable really. I'm just filing here. Because he will pop up, but and he does have a callback, I think, for that special attack timer, but nothing happens. So let's add something to happen. So I guess I don't have it, but here it would be. Affected, override, void, on attack timer. So I'm going to say On attack timer, we are going to, if just change state, if Emburrow state is surfaced, then we dive. Yeah, actually, I do need it. I was wondering if I could just do another like tertiary statement where we just change way past the thing, but we do want an if because we want to teleport them. But I guess I can just teleport them in the switch. Maybe let's do that. So we will do that. We'll do bool be surfaced bools m state bools surfaced. Yeah. And then we change state be surfaced. Zero states diving or otherwise zero state surfacing. Okay. So what should happen? We now should see the boss alternate. He should go up at first, and then that'll unpause the timer. And then when the timer hits, he's going to see that he's surfaced, and so he's going to dive back down. And then when he gets to where the dive point, he'll switch into Burrowed, which will unpause the timer. And then when the timer hits again, he'll surface, because this will be false, so we'll go to the else case, it'll be surfacing. So really, our guy should just be alternating between burrowing and surfacing, over and over. 2.5 seconds is probably fine for an attack frequency. Actually, even let's give it a little bit more wiggle room. I just want to make sure it has enough time to finish its movement. Day goes up, hanging out for a bit. Is anything gonna happen? Going back down, bud. Oh no, he went up again. Done something wrong. Let's see what happens next. Up, up, all the time up. Okay. All right. So why is that? For starters, probably need to be an absolute value here. That actually could be the problem, right? Because if he's above, it's a negative. It means it immediately passed the check and it never actually goes down. So I think that absolute value was the problem there. Let's find out. All right, he's going up, he's going down. This is what we want to see. All right. Next up is the teleport aspect of it. When he goes down, we're going to teleport him as well. So we need a few spots. Let's use our player as the measuring stick as always. I think one here will be like negative 5.5 and negative 13.5. 13.5, I gotta get some water. Non-stop talking, tires on my voice. It's useful in rubber ducking problems. All right, negative 5.5, 13.5. So let's add those as constants here. K spawn Y mid. We'll leave this for a second, but K spawn Y bot, negative 13.5. And then we have K spawn X bot is 5.5. Okay. Let's measure our mid distances, or I guess positions. Something like here-ish, like off to the side, so you can't quite get it from the left. All right, so that would be negative 8, negative 5.5, probably, right? Yeah, and this even needs to be probably slightly lower to accommodate for being burrowed. So this is negative 5.5. And this probably negative, right? I don't think this is right. Yeah, this is negative 13.5. So top mid bot, they have the X bot. I might as well just put the X top just for consistency. Oops, I did the window switch thing. Even though it's zero, I could have it be to zero, but just have the sort of collection of positions here in a consistent format. Okay, we need the left and right mid, which I forget. Distracted. Negative 8, that's what it was. So that's this one. And I should flip these because they're YX, which is just begging for confusion. Okay. And now we are going to turn this into an array of spawn positions. So this will be a private vector 2 array m spawn positions. And we will set these up on start. Equals new vector 2. So we'll have top mid be our first one. On y top. Spawn x top, okay. Spawn y top. This is top mid. Next, we will have mid left. So this is spawn x mid, the negative form. Y mid, comma. It's not right. What's the problem? You sure? Oh, I forgot to capitalize X. Okay, positive X, same Y. This is mid right. Copy these two. Or bottom. 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 All right, so five possible places we can go. And we're also going to have our index. So we know not to rule ourselves. Void am spawn index is initially going to be zero. That's why we put top mid as the first item in the array. Not void int. I should be clearer. Spawn position index. So. Here are five possible spawn positions starting at zero. So we want a helper function here. Probably around like here. Private void teleport to new position. What we're going to do. Instead of guessing and checking, what we can do is just instead of rolling like 0 to 4, we roll 0 to 3 and then add that to the index we are and modulate that. That makes sense. So it just guarantees we don't roll the same position twice in a row. So say int new position equals random dot range between zero, or I guess one, because we're always going to offset by one. So one, I guess I can go one to max. Rather than, yeah, it just needs to be reduced by one on one side of it. Okay, so one to the spawn positions or whatever. Spawn positions dot to length. And then new. And I can just say m spawn position index is equal to new position plus or I'm spawn position index plus new position modulated by the length. Not divide, modulate. Modulo? What's the verb of modulo? New position index, really. Okay. So now we have an index that should be guaranteed to fall within our range of indices and also be guaranteed to be different than the index we previously had. And so we just get mspawn boss dot transform dot position is equal to spawn positions at mspawn position index. Okay, and when we arrive in Burrowed, we teleport to a new position. So that means we would have gone all the way down. All right, let's see it work. In theory, this should be sort of the complete picture of movement we hope to achieve, where he burrows up. Oh, compiler error. But where he burrows up, this opening. 17. I have to figure out where I need to fix that. Need to open 2022. I just see the line number 41 and 43. What's the problem? 41, empty character. Literal? I think I might have just missed a save. I had some garbage in there by accident. Okay, he's going up. He's going back down, and he popped down to there. So that Y position is off. It'll need to be down a little bit. That's okay for now. Let's just make sure he hops around properly. Goes back up to the middle. That's fine. We just want to make sure that's not a repeat trend. Oh, and the target becomes wrong on the second try. Okay, why is that? Where are we setting the target? Current target Y is set here. Oh, okay. We need to teleport first. Well, no, because we should never be doing these in the same frame. Let me double check this. See Unity? I don't want to actually do that. Let's double check. Because that's another thing I noticed. Nice thing about the new Unity, like debugging support is toggleable. So, just as we've been working up to this point, we've been going a lot faster. The iteration time is a lot faster than it would have been, the recompilation, because debugging is disabled by default. Let me just double check this code before I include that. This is not correct. I think I just want to debug.log current target Y. Problem here. Should be fine. I don't know. Yeah, let's debug log first. See what's up. Hopefully it repros. It would suck if it was some combination of like the order that things happened and he's going up. All good. Come back down. Say, oh, what happened? Again with this. Okay. I am not sure. Let me debug log this. Maybe this idea is boss IDX index is fine. X dot to string. Let's see. Let's see. 8.75, but it rolls at first. Where are you going up to, bud? Our guy go. Burrow boss. He's up to 18. Why is that? I forced him back to where he should be. No, but 8.75. Oh, you know what it is, I think? There's like a, I think there's like a concept of inertia where you do want to tell it if your move back is zero. And it stops moving. I don't know, let's double check. I think that might be the case. Where it's just like a sticky thing. The movement isn't like auto resetting every frame. So if I set up and then I just like stop giving it movement commands, it'll just keep going up. It was working earlier. Something with this teleporting handling is wrong. I'm really not sure. What the heck? So he went into diving. His deck was down. He did his move. Deck would not have been zero. Get the delta. Maybe this is too small. Like, it could be that it's blowing past it, and then because it's an absolute value, it'll be too big in the negative direction. I guess that would be a function of movement speed too. So if that is the case, better to notice it now and then notice it as a weird phase bug as I improve movement speed. That kind of worked. It's probably a little bit too instant for me. But I guess if it were hiding itself completely by the end, it's fine. It just needs the slightest delay. Let's add a private constant float k teleport delay. I think it only needs a delay of, say, like a quarter of a second. And then while we're here, we want to decrease all these values. Let's probably just decrease them by one, see if that's right. All the y values where it was like not going down enough. Pop back over here. And get back in the game. Okay. Boy's going up. Go back down. Teleport. Oh, we didn't actually implement the delay. This is just checking the Ys. The middle Y is still a little bit too high. That's the top. That's totally fine. Come on, my boy. The other middle, I just want to see the bottom. The knowledge that he will one day roll the bottom row fills me with determination. Oh my gosh. Is my logic wrong? Don't think so. Is it just really unlucky? Oh yeah, there we go. There it is. All right, so it needs to be slightly further down on the bottom and like a good chunk further down on the middle. Do that. And That problem was fixed, so I guess it was a matter of overshooting it. Should make that a constant so it's clear. Something like private const float k surface, or I guess it's k position check distance. This. And then here in our state change, we don't teleport to a new position right away. Instead, we're going to invoke teleporting to a new position at a delay of whatever that delay I just said. Teleport delay. Telesense is definitely better in Visual Studio 2022. It's bumping, it's guessing what I might want and bumping it to the top, and it is usually pretty correct. All right, guys, going up. Going back down. Switching over here. I forgot to change the Ys. What am I testing? Oh, right, testing that the delay. It does seem to be delaying. Yeah, you saw he came to like a complete stop there. But we can probably still slightly tweak up the delay and change the Y positions again. So this probably just needs to be negative 15.5, not a full. This, I think, needs a whole like 1.25, so that'd be negative 5.75. And then delay, let's update it to 0.35 seconds. Okay, it's coming up. Come back down. Still too tall in the middle. I'm going back to the other middle. I'll just roll the bottom, my friend. I should turn the roll up, the attack roll. All right, there's the bottom. The bottom distance is fine. So we probably just need another 7.5 on the middle, I think. Well, I guess 6.5, yeah. Let's see if that is the case. Okay, he's going up. Still further down. I probably guess that to be good enough. I mean, how long does it take to turn down the timer? I'm thinking of it too. So that would be in where we're setting up our phase data. Oh, whoops. Just 2.75, make that go a little bit quicker. But still, hopefully, long enough to be able to contain the movement. Okay, going up. Going back down. That position is good. The delay is good. Maybe the bottom. No, I think it's fine. Not consistent, I guess. That would be a polish note. I should add that as a note. This is boss base. B, and then we also have burrow. You're on burrow. Be more exact about Y position offsets top mid bot. Okay. Hop back here. So yeah, that is the movement. That's the teleporting. That's everything we need. I think we call this done. Bam. Cool. Next up, projectiles here. Projectiles. So projectiles should be pretty easy because there's oh, let me get rid of the debug prints while I'm thinking of it. Need these. I don't want them clogging up the console in case I do want to debug print something else. Okay. Projectiles, I already have like in my component library. I think I have a decent amount of stuff for them. So we'll see how easy it is. I guess for starters, we need to make the object of the projectile. So we're going to make an empty object here. We're going to call it Burrow projectile. Set it to 0 from its crazy position. Add a sprite renderer. A square is fine for now. Give it a slight color. 45 degree rotation and size. That's a projectile. Box collider is fine. Just make sure it's lined up properly. It looks to be. Oh, I clicked the projectile. Yeah, it's set up. Okay. So we have our project. All right, and then we need to set it to the enemy layer, so it'll hurt the player. And we something like damage other on trigger enter. The other tag we're gonna be damaging is the player. Fire on enter. It's for one. Destroy self can only fire once. Then we add a QI destroyer to be the other side of that destroy request. I don't think we need the delay. We'll deal with that later if we want to add like a little fade animation to this particle. But for now, this should be good enough for our projectile. We're gonna go to project and pull it into here. Burrow projectile. Cool. Okay. Now, on our Burrow boss, we want to add QSPN for spawn error, I believe. Yeah, spawn shoot. The prefab is. Oh, I guess I. Can I not reference other prefabs? I can. For a projectile. Shot speed. How do you know what you're shooting at? Where do you sh what direction do you shoot? Take a look at the script. It's gonna open. Ah, 22. Yeah, it's trying to open 2017. Thank you. Get out of here, 2017. It did a loud window sound in my ear. Alright. QSPN, nice shoot. Take a look. Oh, you just give it a direction, position and stuff. Call it. All right, that's fine. Yeah, this is fine. Okay. So we're gonna add, we already have that on the Burrow projectile guy. Let me this. LE 2017 open, if that's what Uni's gonna open to, it's fine. So here's our dude, we just need to get that shooting interface and shoot. And then here, we would add something like a above all these private void shoot volley. Oh, I guess we need to make this like work how we want. We will need to update those prefabs to give them gravity. Let's see that really quick. Actually, let me look at how is my is this shoot interface. Do spawn here. Post spawn setup. Okay, so it does some post spawn setup maybe. Checks if it has a movement interface and sets its speed. And if it is a like a directional thing, it lets you set its direction. I guess it assumed it would be MBC specific direction. Because this is like what you'd use for a bullet, right? You'd always want a bullet to go in a specific direction. But I don't want that. I don't know if I actually want to use this shoot component. I don't think this helps me. I get rid of it and then just hand, and I'm gonna close 2017, back over to 2022. I'm just gonna have, let's have the prefab instead. Game object. I mean, this would be the pattern I was following with other guys anyway. Projectile prefab. Okay. And then in our shoot volley. Well, first let's add those necessary physics components to our projectiles. So we're going to go to prefabs, pluses for projectile, and we're going to add a rigid body 2D that is dynamic, has some mass, has gravity. What else? I don't think anything else. Oh, and I guess, so like a burst movement, QMBB, I think. It's like a knockback thing, a multi-burst lock. You know that component was created for some like to handle some real nonsense. I wonder what that was for. I guess like maybe somebody had a dash, but also could be knocked back, and you wanted to lock, I don't know, the interface. When you're getting hit by one but not the other or something. Yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So with a rigid body, I can just add a force. I don't actually need a movement interface. This is the wrong Visual Studio, this one. Okay. So let's make one. Well, actually, we probably want two levels of helper here. Because shoot value would be like int k num shots is, let's say, 8. We'll probably randomly roll this in the future, but for now. And this also lets us do it with the delay. So let's do that. Private should be a const, by the way. K means const. Constant int, constant float, K, delay between. This should be really small, but just not zero. So then we get a delay here equal to K delay between times I. And then we invoke I guess I should say if I greater than 0 invoke shoot volley impl but else just be call it directly. I don't know if Unity would do that for me under the hood. Maybe it would. Doesn't matter. It's fine. This should be K num shots, not 8. Okay. So in here, we'd say projectile is equal to instantiate of my projectile prefab. At transform and quaternion. Oh wait, no. I need a pos. My pos is going to be my spawn boss position. Transform.position. Okay, there's my position to spawn at. We're going to spawn where our boss guy is. Maybe we can offset this in the future, but for now we're just trying to get stuff working. And in terms of rotation, we just pass identity, which means no rotation. Okay, so there's our projectile. Next, we get the rigid body off of that. Get projectile, projectile, get components, rigid body 2D. Then we say rb.addForce. We want to roll a random vector in like an arc-ish. So vector 2 dir equal to just random dot range 0 to 1, right? I guess the x would be -1 to 1. And the Y would be 0 to 1 if we want it to be a like a hemisphere. Only positive Y, but any X. So yeah. And this needs to be a dot zero. It's gonna roll me an int. Okay. So there is a random normalized direction in a hemisphere. We want to add force in that direction. It's just amount. Yeah. So I don't know. We'll do private con or not private. Constant float a force scale. We'll say I don't know. 400. Get rid of that capital C. I'm gonna copy paste that everywhere. Not everywhere, because we're gonna move these to global constants in a second. K force scale, and the mode is gonna be impulse. Oh, force scale times direction. Okay. So this will spawn a bullet, pick a random 2D vector in a hemisphere, and add some force to that bullet in the hemisphere. So I'm trying to go for like a fountain type movement pattern, to sort of go along with burrowing, you know, surfacing from a burrow. And in the game, surfaced. I forgot to actually call the function, so nothing's gonna happen. Although it's worth noting, I'm not colliding with this test projectile I added. I mean, it's possible it's just missing stuff. Yeah, it is. Wait, that's the Burrow boss. Are you missing stuff? Oh, it should be damaging me as the player. Oh, it needs to be a trigger. I think that's the problem. I set it to a trigger. Let's see if it damages me. I fell through the world. Okay. I think that's fine. I don't want it to have collision with the world. But let's delete the in-game instance, open up our prefab, and make it a trigger. Oh, again, we didn't actually call our function. That's the wrong arrow. Sure. But it compiles, everything's fine, cool. What was it? Shoot volley. Okay, so we're gonna do this. I don't know if this is gonna be permanent thing, but for now, I think I'm gonna do it a short delay after I surface. I'm gonna say K surface volley delay, slightly longer, because the player might want to react, not get blasted. Da 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 da. Actually, maybe there shouldn't be a delay because there's gonna be a warning while it's surfacing anyway. So like when it finally comes up, it's on you. So just do it. All right, so what do we expect to see? We should see that projectile volley now. We're actually calling our function when he surfaces. So now, oh, what happened? It crashed. We didn't assign the prefab. Let's assign the prefab now. So that is on the boss controller. I'm going to tell it, hey, here is the prefab for the projectile sets. Okay. I definitely like the pattern of having like a separate object boss controller being the brain, and then the boss like spawns the other things, including like the primary boss body. Okay, something was null. What was null? Bind project, bind property relative, does it say? Update visual tree? It's schedulers? I have no idea. I'm gonna say that was a fluke. I think that's a Unity infra error. We're gonna clear it. We're gonna try again. It let me continue, so it wasn't fatal. I think I saw a projectile shooting crazily, but since I paused the game, the time delta is wrong. Oh, what is happening with that? Parameter Unity self schedules. This seems like a infra thing. I don't know. It lets me go. That's way too much force. It's like a zillion. Let's go way down. I hope that's not a. I don't want to close Unity and like reopen it now because it might take a second to load and I'm towards the end here anyway. But I hope that's not something I have to go hunt down. And it's just like something that would go away if I close Unity and reopen it. We'll see. Okay, it didn't happen that time anyway. All right, that wasn't it. That wasn't it at all. Still 100 is way too much. Our boy teleported below. Yeah, we need way less impulse for it to be properly pulled down by gravity. Let's just try 10. Put it in a. I want like a fountain archy type projectile movement instead of like a machine gun. 10 even might be too much. I guess 10 should just be like one frame of gravity, right? Well, not one frame if it's impulse, maybe like 1 second's worth of gravity. We'll see. Here you go. What you got? Oh, it's paused on pause. Yeah, that's not enough, but almost. And I guess another thing here, let's constrain the X range. So instead of being a hemisphere, it's more like 45 degrees. So that would be in our shoot volley thing here, this random range we're rolling. Let's go negative a half to a half instead for the X. That makes it a 45 degree upward cone. And then we found 10 impulse, not really enough. Maybe let's update it to 20. I barely want it to go off the ground, but I do want that arc motion. So let's see. We're completing the domain, resetting all those lazy static variables. Okay, it's pop. This is pausing sometimes. Oh, that might have just been. I think that was me being impatient and spamming the play button twice and queuing up two plays. Okay. Too much. Probably middle ground. Maybe a little bit less than the middle ground. Let's call it 14. Once I get like even kind of close, I'm gonna leave it. I'm not gonna fine tune it right now because I probably want to see if I can get one more thing in. Okay, got a guy coming up, and we'll cut it down a little more, and I'm calling 11. All right, I can't help myself. I promise, unless it just peters out, that'll be the last week, and I'll move on to the next thing. Do one more thing before I call it a night. I know the sort of temptation to just peak values and you get it perfect. It's pretty strong. Close enough, close enough. All right. Oh, actually, It is close enough, but I just want to make sure it's still sending on these other places. Like when he spawns at the other places, is he still going? So he's going to go down, he's going to teleport, he's going to pop up here. Go blah, 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 blah. Okay, looks good. Let's just, we get one in the middle just to double check, feel good about everything working. How is the guy? That seems like it's so. Oh, I got an idea. And that looks fine too. But my idea here is even though we cut the X range in half, if we don't guarantee some amount of Y, then it still could end up being, after being normalized, like a mostly horizontal vector, right? Because if I rolled 0 for the Y, it doesn't matter if I rolled like 0, 0, 1 for the X. That 0, 0, 1 is going to get normalized to like 0.999. So this should get more of that arc we're looking for. Yeah, mostly up out of the middle. Oh, I guess I should try to get hit by one of those. You hit me? Oh crap, I even trying to get hit, it didn't hit me. But I guess maybe that's a good difficulty for All right, it did not hit me. Dang. What's the problem? Let me click one of these. It is on the enemy layer. Oh, you know what? I think it actually needs to be on the enemy knockback trigger layer. Enemy, I think this is misleading and my own fault for like for naming. I think enemy is for like enemy visuals. Enemy knockback trigger is for the enemy's like actual hurt box. Let's see. So this sh I want to make sure this actually hurts me. What? What do I need to? Sometimes you need to close the prefab in the Unity editor, or it messes up dealing with the prefab in the game. Now I don't see them. They just like, oh, they're just at, you know, layer 0, I bet, right? All right, click the wrong thing there. Well, there I put them at 15. They didn't show up. Why aren't you showing up? What is the problem here? They're in a weird shader. Oh, lit. Yeah, there might be no lights in here. Unlit. Oh, cool. Yeah. So projectile, let's switch you to unlit. I probably want to move things to lit materials at some point, but I don't have the lights set up. I just have like the most basic implementation. So we got sprite unlit defaults, and we're gonna move you to like 16, very front. And that actually gave me an idea. I can add another below hurt box. I'm trying to. I think I want to go for like a consistent idea of their like just a consistent messaging and signaling about like what can hurt you. I think I'm going to do that with red glow on the edges. So I also want to then turn down, want to turn down like the brightness of the main projectile glow just so that it's sure to pick up the red and not necessarily the red and the brown. I guess I enemy knockback trigger I think is being affected by post-processing. That's why it was glowing. Let's see. Oh, it dropped. I don't know what the deal with that dropping a bunch is. Like pooping a bunch out. It is hurting me now though, so that's good. What's the deal with that pooping a bunch out? All right, glow hurt box. You're gonna be on the trigger. Oh. Looking at, okay, they have two sets of collision when they need one. That's a start. Maybe they're, oh yeah, because they're the same rigid body, so one was probably getting forced out of the other. I think it's this is what we want, because this still has the box collider, this has the rigid body, all that. This destroyer we can leave on the parent, damaging the player we leave here, and then this burrow trigger we move back to the enemy layer. So this is like the know this object only. We leave the glow hurt box on the knockback layer. So the end result should be we get no glow from the brown, only glow from the red, and we get the sort of glowing red telegraph we want for things that can hurt you. We'll see. And hopefully that physics... Oh, something broke. There is no rigid body attached. Okay. Since we put the rigid body in the child, we need to update this to get component in children. That should fix that error. Let's try it again. Okay. Boy is about to pop up. If anything, it's being overwhelmed by the red. And what's wrong with my boy here? What happened to him? Basically, like, it seems like one is getting stuck in the middle. Take a look. Scene. What's going on here, guy? What happened to you? Oh, this is another pile of guys. All right. So there is something wrong with that spawning logic. Let's take a look at it. Go down to like 10.5, I think. So projectile prefab at POS. Maybe we need to do POS plus like a little bit up. Or. This all looks fine to me. I guess let me restart and watch the spawning behavior, like frame by frame. Okay. And. Oh, I gotta control it's late there. Oh no, you need to capture my. Oh, I figured it out. Cool. I have like some kind of panning the canvas mode on. I don't know why it is doing this. Very annoyed because I don't know how to get out of it. Do this. There's something wrong going on here. I think it's an issue. But, you know, it's not the. It's kind of like the other thing that's hard to reaper. Just switch this maybe. Unpause. All right, cool. Yeah, we switch views. And I guess it crashed the scene view. Let's get that back. No. Close this tab. Oh, it's the only tab. Huh. I know. Let's sort of let it figure itself out again. Let's relaunch Unity. You hate to do it, especially this late. Probably the last thing I'm gonna do. But yeah, we gotta figure out why it's pooping like a giant pile of projectiles. Because that is not desirable behavior. I don't know, I just got this weird thing with Unity. Panels. Window. General scene. I have my layout. Is there a way to switch to like a standard layout? Let's do that. Window layouts wide. Yeah, this is pretty much what I was doing before. Except if I put the hierarchy up here. Yeah, okay. Fixed. Cool. I forget what I was doing, so I was so distracting. Oh, right, the pooping out particles. Yeah, we want to go back into the game. And as the particles are spawning, just step through, sort of, went so quick. But let's see. One. So this one just spawned. There's one in the middle. Going up and out. This one. It seems like they're all going up and out. So what is the one at the middle? Oh. I guess. Seems like the parent. Yeah, look, it's the same object. It's the parent is becoming like divorced from the child. I guess because I put the rigid body on the child. I don't think I need to. I think I can keep the collision on the child with the rigid body being on the parent. And then the child just inherits the parent's movement. Whereas in the case right now, the child will do its movement, but parent doesn't, move because the child does. It's the other way around only. So dynamic, everything else looks fine. I think the collision should still be fine. Let's see. I didn't get hit. I was trying to get hit. Oh, I messed up my game view. Let me get my game view back. I like this game view for my big coding monitor. Kind of interesting. They're like mega energy type thing. Oh, free aspect as well. Like they're just like the sort of visual of them being super dark and having like glow. I think some of like antimatter or something like that. Not really what I was going for. I was going for more like a dust and rocks and stuff. But maybe this in the neon sort of aesthetic, maybe this is what little rocks look like. Yeah, I think this is what we're hoping for, right? We got teleporting burrow behavior. It doesn't look like it because we can see it. But if it were disappearing back into the ground and then we maybe like show a trail to the next one, like through this center vine, perhaps, like some kind of glow trail to just sort of give you the hint of where he's gonna pop up next. Yeah, I think it would feel more burrowy. Anyway, let me take a look at the one now. What do I have slated? Decoys. Trying to think how much work this would be, whether or not I could sneak it in, or if you better just call it here and work on this offline, or maybe next time. Yeah, I think if I'm gonna stick to the schedule I've been doing of like one boss every 2 weeks while I'm making some really nice progress on guts, like the rendering stuff and adding lights and paying some like. Just every week I try and get rid of the worst looking thing. Because if I just keep doing that, eventually it'll look good. Or at least it will be on an upward trajectory of looking good. Anyway, let me hop back into the B-boss level and see if I can get a clean kill on that. I have a weird folder there. This is my burrow. All right. Well, I'm less distracted. So yeah, before I get into that, let me take a peek again at that one note. See what I want to say. Right, okay. Shopping upgrade one UI, one-way platform spline. So yeah. I think shop and upgrade UI is sort of the last piece of like untouched UI. I guess not including this boss test UI, but the last piece of untouched UI after we sort of like did the viewport change that set up like letterboxing. Uh-oh, I hit that one bug. Yeah, another thing I have on my to-do list there is clean up one-way platforms. And one thing is if you trigger a ledge grab in the middle of a one-way, in the inside of a one-way platform like that, it breaks. So that's something I'd be looking to clean up. Also, just see if I can get some ideas for like this kind of visually oriented telegraphing for the Rat King, because I think there are just some pretty placeholder particle effects there. We would probably want to do some work to close the distance between the Rat King and the Bee Queen. Probably just take a similar perspective there, where as I start to get a stable of more and more bosses, just sort of offline every week, take some time, make some of the like less foundational but just quality of life design improvements, more polish upgrades on the bosses. So the B boss will probably, sit at this state for a bit. Probably clean up the rat boss next, and then next Tuesday when we finish up the Burrow boss's behaviors, that offline week will probably be spent cleaning him up as well. And then I think I'll probably try to do, I'm just getting blasted. I think I'll probably try to do one more like 2 week thing on stream of one last boss on stream after the Burrow boss. And then I'll be putting it all together. I know I've been saying that for a bit. I've been like pretty close for a bit, but working on the bosses is kind of a way to sort of remain productive on stream, while making like some pretty like invasive changes to the main level stuff. So like I don't necessarily know if I want to hop in the main level where it might be in a really broken or like placeholder state. So just hopping into these sort of isolated boss test levels as I do like a sort of more just sort of fixing the guts and making upgrades to the like the core stuff associated with the main level. And that's just like gonna be hours of me looking at code, so that doesn't really make for interesting stream content. Get up! Ah! Oh my god, I'm so close. It's probably three more hits. I'll get them. Yeah, three more hits, so two more. Anyway, so yeah. Next Tuesday, gonna do another round of stuff for Burrow Boss. The remaining stuff is not that complicated. If you look at like even the blue flies doing that orbit motion, they took up a lot of time in week two of B Boss. There's nothing like that. We're just dropping projectiles from the ceiling, and then we're just like spawning like little areas that'll do the same projectile volley we already set up. It's really just a matter of, I felt like, well, I need the telegraph. The telegraph is like such an important part of that decoy attack, you know? Oh, got blasted for 30 damage so bad. Just not paying attention, mostly talking. But yeah, that is gonna be it for me for today. Offline, like I said, shop and upgrade UI, some platforming cleanup like these bad boys. And rat boss cleanup level system. If this is going to be like sort of prioritized levels, system is probably down here. And more post processing and more post processing integration is like maybe a stretch goal. Maybe we'll get to. Shop and upgrade UI is the main thing because I think that's the one of the last things remaining for this like sort of level integration end-to-end experience. But yeah, thanks for tuning in. If you did, I'm gonna come back next Tuesday. We'll be working on the decoy attack, ceiling debris, the damage. And we can probably, since this is so light, we can probably get it to a good deal of polish type stuff. Maybe playing with the post-processing could be cool. Trying to, find things to make glow, to be good telegraphs and stuff. Maybe having like a little glowy trail to follow the burrowy guy around. A lot of cool options for upgrading our Burrow guy next week. So yeah, if you want to check that out, tune in next Tuesday around 6:30. Yeah, otherwise I will see you. Have a good night. Follow me on all the places. You know what to do.